Slightly sharper inequality if P plus Q is not equal to 1. Very slightly sharper, the minus a half turned into a plus a half. And an upper bound is this. And so both of them go to infinity as Q approaches P in the fashion of a constant over P minus Q. Okay, so they get very large. This number capital N gets very large if Q is near P. And not quite equal to it. It sort of feels like the way it ought to be. And it is. The behavior is quite irregular. To prove the unimodality, what one needs to prove is the monotonicity of that ratio of two consecutive phis as a function of n for fixed x and y. Okay? Phi n plus 1 over phi n is a monotone function of n. To prove that, one has the following. Well, here's a weird condition called admissible. If for every function is admissible, if for every polynomial p, we have p of g is not equal to 0. For example, suppose you had a weird function like one that was plus 1 of the rationals and minus 1 of the irrationals. And I'll take the function p of t equals t squared minus 1. That p of g is identically 0 for that function. And so I'm ruling that out. Nobody really minds if you rule out things. Suppose g of t is admissible for the unimodality b, and h of t is any non-negative function for all t in any. To find the moment sequence, mu sub n is the integral of g of t to the n times h of t dt. And suppose that all mu i's are greater than 0, then mu I plus 1 over mu I is a strictly increasing function of I equals 0, 1, 2, etc. This is basically a theorem about the moment problem, except instead of using t to the nth, we're using a function of t to the nth. And the assumption is that the g is positive. And the proof is sort of obvious. You just look at the quadratic form as the b. Here is the quadratic form, capital H, mu sub I plus j. And then look at its value. The sum of xi and hij xj works out to be the integral of the square of something times a positive function. And so it's certainly positive. And so since h is positive definite, it's 2 by 2 principal minors, excuse me, are positive. And so you get that chain of inequalities up there. That's not quite enough to prove what you want, because we're skipping some things. We have mu 1 over mu 0 less than mu 2 over mu 1. But we wanted mu 1 over mu 0 less than mu, yeah, right. We got this one. We wanted this one between here and here. And that one is not given in this list. So a very slight bit of surgery is necessary here. Namely, replace h of t by g of t, h of t, and then h becomes the matrix mu sub I plus j plus 1. And apply the conclusions of that one, and you discover that all the missing inequalities are also true. And if you put the two of them together, you get the whole chain of increasing inequality that you need, which proves the assertion that the ratios are increasing. Now, that was a lemma about increasing ratios for moments that look like integral of something to the nth power times something else. Well, the Legendre polynomials look exactly that way. They are the integral of the nth power of something times something else. Something else is 1. And the something is positive, very definitely. And so the lemma applies. And so the ratios Pn plus 1 over Pn do increase with n. And so the same is true of Pn plus 1 over Pn, which are obtained from the theorem from that simple transformation. So there's a unique value of n at which this maximum is going to be reached. When n is 0, the ratio is 1 plus xy. When n goes to infinity, the ratio approaches 1 plus square root of xy quantity squared, which is bigger than 1 plus x plus 2y. And it's this thing on the right. I keep repressing your urge to use this as a pointer. when phi n plus 1 over phi n passes through this value is where n is determined. So we're saying at infinity is bigger than that, and at 0 is less than that, and it's monotone in between. So it'll pass through exactly once. So there's a unique n. If p plus q equals 1, and x times y equals 1 and can evaluate this because the Zeilberger polynomials are known. The indicator function, what I'm calling an indicator function, is the thing which, when it's positive, means that the curve is still rising, and when it's negative, the curve is descending. The indicator function in this case is this simple difference that's on the right here. And so it's pretty easy to see where that's positive and where that's negative. So the optimal value of N in that case is capital N, which is equal to that frame right there. Okay? I can't walk past the generating function without acknowledging that it's there, just constitutional there, I can't do that. So here is the generating function of that F of N that we started with way back. The big double sum, the probability that Alice wins, has this generating function. I really don't think I could have gotten that without the result from Zeilberger's algorithm that gives you the recurrence for F of N. That makes it easy. So here is the generating function. Something you can see from the generating function is that F of N is invariant if you replace Q and P, the two probabilities, by 1 minus P and 1 minus Q. The generating function doesn't change. And so the problem doesn't change. The value of capital of N that gives you the optimal is the same as it was before you made that swap. Now that's a simplified that should not require all the forces of heaven to prove, like as I just proved before, one should be able to give a bijective proof. And in fact, one can give a bijective. I will not give it here, but it exists. Okay, so this capital N is invariant under the swap of QP for 1 minus P and 1 minus Q. And there are two proofs. So it's sufficient to find capital N when P plus Q is less than 1. As far as the lower bound is concerned, consider the trapezoid tensor bound defined by those two lines that are stated out there and the diagonal line, P plus Q equals 1. And this is equality. In throughout that trapezoid, the indicator function is positive. Maybe I want to go past this. I think I don't want to do that. Let me instead just show you some pretty pictures. If you take a look at this picture, in the next slide I'll explain what the various colors of curves are, and then I'll back up to this picture again so you can see. So here's a picture of something that shows the upper bound numerically. In the preceding figure, the black curves are where J vanishes. Let's see how we go back. Let me go back on the PC. The backspace doesn't work. Maybe this thing. Okay. So the black curves are the places where the indicator function is zero. And we're looking at the PQ plane here, the two probabilities. The blue lines are a certain family of straight lines, and the red lines are a certain other family of straight lines. And the QP plane, if I back up once more, you'll notice that the curves lie between various pairs of straight lines. And that's how the proof comes. That's all I wanted to say here, is that to prove these facts, you want to show that the curve, which is what you're interested in, lie between some straight lines, and that gives you two-sided bounds on the capital N. Figure suggests that each null climb where J is 0 lies between M sub N and L sub 2 N plus 1. That's the precise statement. And that should give you a bright induction. Here's a little comment about how good the bounds are. Here's a graph in which I'll do the same stunt. I'll say what the various colors mean and then back up to it. But again, we're in the PQ plane. The green region is where the two bounds on the capital N agree. That's like a little cap. So wherever you see green, the upper bound agrees with the lower bound for capital. The red region is where N agrees with the lower bound. And in the combined red and green regions, N is expressible exactly as this max. So in the combined red and green regions, sorry, I passed it. The combined everything but the yellow, in other words, one has a very good hold on what the capital N is. You can actually, it turns out to be amusing that you can calculate the exact probability and you'll get the exact answer for capital N. You don't have to estimate the total area of green, in other words. You can calculate. It's a certain infinite series that you can sum. So I'm about to say that the probability is so-and-so, and those are exact values, they're not roughly, by taking out a planimeter and measuring various areas. So in the figure, the green area where the two bounds agree is 75% of the triangle. And the green plus red area where N equals the lower bound is 97% of the area. here's an open question to keep you busy for the rest of the conference, but not during talks, please. I just say anything for three players, and thank you very much.